We're gonna do a lot of math, step by step by step by step by step, StatQuest. Hello, I'm Josh Starmer and welcome to StatQuest. Today we're going to talk about maximum likelihood for the normal distribution, and it's going to be clearly explained. Note, this StatQuest follows up on the StatQuest, maximum likelihood, clearly explained, as well as the StatQuest, probability versus likelihood. Lastly, this StatQuest assumes you are already familiar with the normal distribution. If not, check out the StatQuest, the normal distribution, clearly explained. Let's start with this nasty-looking equation. It's the equation for the normal distribution, or normal curve. It has two parameters. The first parameter, the Greek character mu, determines the location of the normal distribution's mean. A smaller value for mu moves the mean of the distribution to the left, and a larger value for mu moves the mean of the distribution to the right. The second parameter, the Greek character sigma, is the standard deviation and determines the normal distribution's width. A larger value for sigma makes the normal curve shorter and wider, and a smaller value for sigma makes the normal curve taller and narrower. In this StatQuest, we're going to use the likelihood of the normal distribution to find the optimal parameters for mu, the mean, and sigma, the standard deviation, given some data, x. Let's start with the simplest data set of all, a single measurement. Here, we've measured a single mouse, and it weighs 32 grams. Now, just to see what happens, we can overlay a normal distribution with mu equals 28 and sigma equals 2 onto the data. To determine the likelihood of the data given this curve, we can plug the numbers into the likelihood function, and then plug the numbers into this equation. And here's the equation with mu equals 28, sigma equals 2, and x equals 32 plugged in. Now just do the math. Plug and chug, plug and chug. And the likelihood of the curve with mu equals 30 and sigma equals 2, given the data, is 0.03. Thus, the y-axis value here is 0.03. Now we can shift the distribution a little bit to the right by setting mu equals 30 and then calculate the likelihood. Again, we just plug the numbers into the likelihood function. And now we just plug and chug. And the likelihood of the new curve with mu equals 30 and sigma equals 2, given the data, is 0.12. Thus, the y-axis value here is 0.12. If we decide to fix sigma equals 2 so that it is a given, just like the data, then we can plug in a whole bunch of values for mu and see which one gives the maximum likelihood. For example, if we start with the mean of the distribution over here on the left at 20 grams, then we plug mu equals 20 into the equation, and we get a crazy small likelihood. And then we can plot the likelihood on a graph. The y-axis is the likelihood value, and the x-axis is for the different values that we plug in for mu. Each time we change mu, we calculate the likelihood and plot it. We can identify the peak in the likelihood graph by determining where the slope of the curve equals zero. In this case, the slope equals zero when mu equals 32. Now we can fix mu equals 32 and treat it like a given, just like the data. And we can plug in different values for sigma to find the one that gives the maximum likelihood. Note, you actually need more than one measurement to find the optimal value for sigma. I'll leave the reason why as an exercise for the viewer. That said, if we had more data, then we could plot the likelihoods for different values of sigma. And the maximum likelihood estimate for sigma would be at the peak, where the slope of the curve equals zero. The goal of this super simple example is to convey the basic concepts of how to find the maximum likelihood estimates for mu and sigma. To solve for the maximum likelihood estimate for mu, we treat sigma like it's a constant, and then find where the slope of its likelihood function is zero. And to solve for the maximum likelihood estimate for sigma, we treat mu like it's a constant, and then find where the slope of its likelihood function is zero. The example with one measurement kept the math simple, but now I think we're ready to dive in a little deeper. So let's use a two-sample data set to calculate the likelihood of a normal distribution. Crazy times! To keep track of things, let's call the mouse that weighs 32 grams x sub 1, and the mouse that weighs 34 grams x sub 2. And again, just to see what happens, let's overlay a normal distribution with mu equals 28 and sigma equals 2 onto the data. We've already seen how to calculate the likelihood for this curve given x sub 1, the mouse that weighs 32 grams. And we can calculate the likelihood for the curve given x sub 2 by plugging in 34 into this likelihood function. But what's the likelihood of this normal curve given both x sub 1 and x sub 2? In other words, what's this? Because these measurements are independent, i.e., weighing x sub 1 did not have an effect on weighing x sub 2, the likelihood of a normal distribution with mu equals 28 and sigma equals 2, given the data x sub 1 equals 32 and x sub 2 equals 34, is just the likelihood of the distribution given x sub 1 times the likelihood of the distribution given x sub 2. So we just plug in the numbers and do the math. And that gives us a really small number. If we had a third data point, then we just add it to the given side of the overall likelihood and add another individual likelihood term to our multiplication. With n data points, we add all n data points to the given side of the overall likelihood function, then multiply together all n individual likelihood functions. Bam! Now that we know how to calculate the likelihood of a normal distribution when we have more than one measurement, we just multiply together the individual likelihoods, let's solve for the maximum likelihood estimates for mu and sigma. Brace yourself for a lot of math. But don't freak out, we'll go through it one step at a time. Here's the likelihood function without any value specified for mu and sigma. It equals the product of the likelihood functions for the n individual measurements. And here's what the equation looks like. What we need to do is take two different derivatives of this equation. One derivative will be with respect to mu, when we treat sigma like it's a constant. And we can find the maximum likelihood estimate for mu by finding where this derivative equals zero. The other derivative will be with respect to sigma, when we treat mu like it's a constant. And we can find the maximum likelihood estimate for sigma by finding where this derivative equals zero. But before we try to take any derivatives, let's take the log of the likelihood function. We do this because it makes taking the derivative way, way easier. And the likelihood function and the log of the likelihood function both peak at the same values for mu and sigma. I know it's hard to tell that the log likelihood function for sigma peaks here, but just take my word for it. I double-checked. Here's the log of the likelihood. Now we're going to go, step by step, through all of the transformations that the log has on this function. Just a heads up, the log is going to do a lot of transformations to this function, so hang in there. First, the log transforms the multiplication into addition. Now we log transform the individual likelihood functions. Let's focus on this one first. Step 1. Move the log of the first likelihood function to the top left-hand side of the screen for reference. Step 2. Convert the multiplication into addition. Step 3. Convert 1 over the square root into the exponent negative 1/2. And convert the exponent into multiplication. Step 4. Convert the negative 1/2 exponent into multiplication. And the log of e equals 1. So we can remove it. Step 5. The log can convert the multiplication of 2 times pi times sigma squared into addition of 2 times pi and sigma squared. And there's nothing more to do to this term. So it doesn't change. Step 6. Convert the exponent in the log of sigma squared into 2 times the log of sigma. Step 7. Lastly, the 2 divided by 2 term cancels out. Bam! We started with this, and after the log transformation, ended up with this. I know all of this log transformation stuff looks bonkers the first time you see it. Just remember, it will make it easier to take the derivative. So now we can go back to the original likelihood and turn this into this. And by following the same steps, we can transform the remaining parts of the sum into this. Now let's simplify this equation. Just to be clear about how we simplify, keep in mind that since we have n data points, that means we have a term for the first data point, x sub 1, and that this represents the terms for the remaining n minus 1 data points. So we can combine this from the first term with the remaining n minus 1 occurrences. 1 plus n minus 1 equals n. Then, all n of the negative log of sigmas can be combined. And the last parts of each term stay the same. This is the log of the likelihood function after simplification, and it is what we will take the derivative of. So let's move it to the top for reference. We'll start by taking the derivative with respect to mu. This derivative is the slope function for the log of the likelihood curve, and we'll use it to find the peak, aka where the slope equals 0. The first term doesn't contain mu, so its derivative is 0. The second term doesn't contain mu either, so its derivative is also 0. The third term contains mu, so now we have to work. Specifically, the numerator contains mu, and we have to apply the chain rule. So we start with the outer derivative of negative 32 minus mu squared. And then we multiply that by the derivative of 32 minus mu. And then we simplify. Because the derivative is with respect to mu, sigma is a constant, and thus, the denominator doesn't change. So we can combine the two pieces. And the twos cancel out. And that means the derivative of this is this. Likewise, we apply the chain rule to the remaining terms and get these. Bam! Now we can simplify the equation. These zeros go away, and we can pull the sigma squared out and add the numerators together. Then we can combine the measurements. And lastly, we can combine the mu's. Thus, this is the derivative of the log likelihood function with respect to mu. Double bam! Now let's take the derivative of the log likelihood function with respect to sigma. This derivative is the slope function for the log of the likelihood curve. And we'll use it to find the peak, which is hard to see in this graph. So, from here on out, because they peak at the same spot, I'll show you the likelihood functions instead of the log likelihood functions. The first term doesn't contain sigma, so its derivative is 0. The derivative of the second term is just n over sigma. The derivative of this term isn't tricky, but it's easier to figure out when we rewrite 1 over sigma squared as sigma to the negative 2. Since we're taking the derivative with respect to sigma, this part can be treated like a big constant. And the derivative of this is this. The two negatives cancel out. And then the twos cancel out. And lastly, we put sigma back into the denominator by changing the sign of the exponent. So the derivative of this is this. So that's what we put into the equation. Likewise, the derivatives of the remaining terms simplify to these. Bam! This is the derivative of the log likelihood function with respect to sigma. We can simplify the equation by omitting the 0, leaving the second term the same, and we can pull the sigma cubed out and add up the remaining terms. Double bam! At long last, here are the two derivatives. To find the maximum likelihood estimate for mu, we need to solve for where the derivative with respect to mu equals 0, because the slope is 0 at the peak of the curve. Likewise, to find the maximum likelihood estimate for sigma, we need to solve for where the derivative with respect to sigma equals 0, because the slope is 0 at the peak of the curve. We'll start by setting the derivative with respect to mu to 0, and solve for mu. We start by multiplying both sides by sigma squared. That makes the sigma squared go away. Then we add n times mu to both sides. Divide both sides by n and solve. Thus, the maximum likelihood estimate for mu is the mean of the measurements. So that is where the center of our normal curve will go. Don't get too excited, we're not done yet. Dang! Now we need to set the derivative with respect to sigma to 0. Now multiply both sides by sigma. Add n to both sides. Multiply both sides by sigma squared. Divide both sides by n, and take the square root of both sides. And, at long last, we see that the maximum likelihood estimate for sigma is the standard deviation of the measurements. Thus, we use the formula for the standard deviation to determine the width of the normal curve that, given the data, has the maximum likelihood. In summary, the mean of the data is the maximum likelihood estimate for where the center of the normal distribution should go, and the standard deviation of the data is the maximum likelihood estimate of how wide the normal curve should be. Note, these solutions may be obvious, but now we have the math that proves that our intuition is correct. Wait for it. Triple bam! Hooray! We've made it to the end of another exciting StatQuest. If you like this StatQuest and want to see more of them, please subscribe. And if you want to support StatQuest, well, please consider buying one or two of my original songs. All right, until next time, quest on!